Let's get lively tonight. I wanted to start off with something really hot, really, really inexplicable, just something to shatter your imagination right off the top. So we're going to start with something I call Can Man. This is a found piece of footage from another place and time with a Gainsbourg track dumped on top of it. I hope this provokes a reaction in you, because if this doesn't, then our second clip definitely will. Wow, that exists, because the question is always not what the fuck, question mark, exclamation point. The question isn't that. It should be, why does this exist, question mark.
Excuse me. Who are you talking to?
Oh, nobody in particular. I'm just trying to look cool, you know what I mean?
All right. If you're just joining us, this is the Museum of Home Video. We do this every week on Tuesdays from 7:30 to 9 o'clock. This is pirate television for the soul. This is college radio for your eyes. This is the reason television was invented.
Nuggets, tenders, nuggets, McNugget, McNugget, nugget, nuggetization, nuggets.
My name is Brett Berg, and I am the creator/VJ on the Museum of Home Video. I originate a lot of the video material you see on the show. I reach out to a lot of the guests, and I keep the show fresh and fucked up every week.
I'm Jenny Nixon, and I'm the producer at Museum of Home Video. And my role is basically to assist Brett in realizing his vision for this crazy program, and also to keep the technological fires running in terms of our social media, our website, our merch, and the community building stuff that we do with our viewers.
To me, the Museum of Home Video is 90 minutes of found footage for stoners, seekers, archivists, and drinkers. I'm pretty sure that everybody in the audience falls into one of those four categories. And it is a show born out of my own found footage collection, which is now stretched to 50 terabytes. I've been gathering material for almost 20 years without any real plan as to what to do with it. And during lockdown, a show idea that Jenny and I had that was supposed to be an IRL event every week is now transposed onto Twitch, because it's what we can do. And also, it's a fun evolution of the idea.
It's like the return of destination viewing. You know, when you used to have three channels, if there was a program you liked, you had to tune in and watch it. And while we do have our Patreons so that people can watch archives of past episodes, I feel like the live stream aspect of it, with the live chat going and the community that's there, it just makes it like a party that you look forward to going to every week.
Are you going to entertain us with music during these weather reports?
Yes, sir. Mr. Coleman?
There will be about 14 minutes of music per hour on the Weather Channel. Every 1 minute out of every five, when we have the local forecast, you will hear music, and we are making a strong effort to see that it's varied, that it's current, that it's bright, that it's happy, that it's upbeat. And I really think that some people will stay tuned to the Weather Channel just to keep up with the music. They may begin to think of our meteorologists as part disc jockeys.
We'd now like to push the ceremonial button that's going to begin this service. Frank?
Before I do push the button, I'd like to say that it's been quite a challenge and an education also to start a national medium from scratch.
So starting a show like this in a quarantine, it's an entirely different context than what I had originally envisioned. But I mean, I have to say, I almost feel guilty sometimes for how much it's added to my life in this past year. I mean, on a personal level, you know, a lot of life is shit, you know, but on a creative level, being able to do this with Brett and realize some things that we've been talking about for years, not knowing what form they would take, you know, the quarantine sort of helped us shape it into something new that I don't think either of us had, you know, envisioned or ever could have.
In the many years leading up to to the lockdown era, I would say several startups have attempted what was they used to call a second screen experience, which means that you're in a theater, you're watching a movie, and you have your phone out and you are using some app to communicate with other people in the theater, or what you're saying is your tweet is then mirrored on screen. I guess it was inspired by seeing TV programs where people were doing the same thing. But in all instances, it's been a really bad user experience. I don't know of anybody who's clamored for the second screen experience. This was an IRL event that then we reconfigured for Twitch, which is a fantastic medium because it has the video and the chat. We didn't realize how much the chat fed into the community part and how vital it was. Even though something like 20% of the total viewership participates in the chat became like the show as much as the video.
You know, if we were doing this show IRL and you were in the audience, you know, if you were muttering to your friend, it would be extremely rude. And, you know, I mean, some laughs here and there, yeah, that's acceptable, but let's not go crazy. It's just doing the show on a platform like Twitch is a whole different experience than doing it in a club with, you know, darkened lights and a big crowd sitting in chairs. I just feel like it really helps people feel connected. It's nice that if people have questions about something or they're discovering something for the first time via our show, there will be people there who already know about it and say, oh, well, if you like this, you might like this, and they can drop a link instantly. You know, you would think that typing away takes away from the viewing. But to me, with this kind of show, it really, that conversation enhances it.
The chat is a party, and people like to come to the party without having to put on new socks.
There is something really fun about it. There's, especially in the age of COVID, when we're not able to hang out with our friends, this is, you know, a way of bonding and feeling not so alone. People have told us, you know, this has saved my quarantine. And that means a lot because it saved ours too.
Yes, this is very clearly my video therapy.
Oh, for sure.
Producing this show.
For sure. Yeah. I look forward to it so much.
What you see in the chat is a reflection of what I had hoped would come across to the audience. And like a lot of found footage makers and a lot of found footage shows, IRL and online, take a distanced, ironic stance to the material. I think that's kind of like standard. We also do that too. I'm not saying that we don't. But the fact that we've engineered the show to be found footage that you can feel, like what we put on screen is stuff that I want you to have a reaction to. Not a whoa, what the fuck kind of reaction. I mean, you can have that reaction, but I also want people to examine their own lives and their own consumption of media.
This supply and demand cycle created by this doll is a marketer's dream.
The owner of the company decided to treat it like a collectible, like a Hummel or a collector plate, and buy it from a customer and then quickly sell it for a very low profit.
So people are coming in here, selling their $20 dolls to the store for $40.
The store then turns around and resells them for $50. Most buyers can't express why this doll is so popular this year, and others can't explain why they want to buy it, but they do want it.
I don't like them. I don't like them. I don't like their faces, but I want one.
My relationship with archiving, whether from an armchair or in a professional sense, definitely started with home taping. Absolutely. I would say more so TV than radio, although I was a huge consumer of radio. Living, growing up in Los Angeles, that being one of the biggest radio markets in the country, I just had access to a lot of, you know, content. But I definitely, absolutely was taping stuff off cable. As a kid, I was not a video store kid. I was a cable TV kid. I feel very privileged. Like I realize now that a lot of movie fiends did not grow up with such a luxury in their house. My parents never took me to the video store because they kept saying, we pay for cable. Why would we rent videos? So cable TV was definitely my film education as a kid. I like to say that the anonymous programmers of HBO, Showtime, and the Movie Channel taught me more about movies than any professor or any school setting. So I would tape things off of cable constantly. I had no content restriction, strictly because my parents didn't realize that I knew how to program the VCR while they didn't. I guess they figured because they didn't know, I didn't know either. And I would, as I got into my high school years, we got the TV guide every week in the mail, and I would bust out the highlighter and just go through the late night sections and highlight 2 to 3 movies a night that I wanted to tape. It was kind of my proto TiVo. And amassed a collection, not too big of a collection of things taped off cable, because I would reuse the tape so often and keep stuff. But I would say the tapes that got the most play in my house at that time were Tarkovsky, Lynch, Ken Russell, and the Police Academy movies, I would say. But those were my treasured tapes. Don't have any of them left. For someone who was such a big physical media person back in the day, I have nothing remains from my childhood collections. Nothing remains from my 20s collections, really. I have boiled it all down to these hard drives, which are so wonderful. You can put them in one box and throw them all in your car, as opposed to moving your entire house. It's very, very handy.
My dad was a big collector. He, I tell this story all the time, but we were one of the first families that had a VCR. He and his buddies would rent things and, you know, throw 3 movies on a tape. We were duping things illegally from way back. And he would fill shelves in our house with, you know, these home dubbed movies. And then he had composition notebooks that he would fill out. Everybody in my family's name starts with J. Okay. And my dad, John, had a rating system. So he would list each, like he would number with little stickers, each video cassette, like, okay, this one has Easy Money, Real Genius, and, you know, I don't know, Sorcerer, whatever. And he would write down the number of the cassette, the titles that were on that cassette, and then he would give it a rating, 1 to 4 J's. And so I was sort of predisposed to grow up thinking this nerdy sort of stuff is super cute, always dubbing things off the TV, you know, always interested in weird stuff.
Even though I had friends in elementary school, junior high school to talk film with and to nerd out about things with, my enjoyment of cable TV as a package was pretty solitary. My parents had tastes which were so opposite mine. Did my parents have taste? Not sure, you know? But I don't know. I was in a vacuum when it came to my appreciation of the overall like aesthetic package of HBO. When we showed the HBO in Space making of segment, it really touched a nerve for the audience. And it showed me just how universal some of that ephemera was to people who I didn't know.
Christmas is just about slave labor for the women. There's an easy way and a difficult way of handling it.
I can put my hand underneath,
lubricate it, and you simply bend the handle upwards. This curious pinching movement erupts over all those little holes and starts running down in rivulets.
A lot of people ask me, where does all the material from the show come from? Is it all from YouTube? And the answer to that is, I would say it's 20 to 25% YouTube in select places. But the majority of it comes from my own personal collection that I started about 20 years ago as a manager at Cinephile Video in Santa Monica, because we specialized in rare, out of print, hard to find bootleg tapes and then discs. I had at my disposal an entire archive to copy, basically. And I started doing that early on. As soon as I got some portable hard drives, which back then, 20 years ago, a 1 terabyte hard drive was $1,000. Now it is under 100. And look how far we've come. So my collection progressed along with the expansiveness of hard drive capacities. And at this point, I've amassed an archive of video, audio, and print, which is about 50 terabytes worth of stuff. And that is all redundantly backed up onto other drives. And these aren't cheap, hence the Patreon. But I decided, before I started the show, I actually wanted to name my collection something, because people take things more seriously if you name them. And people name stuff as silly as their car, so why not name my hard drives? And it's the museum. It is the Museum of Home Video. The material we cut and show on the show falls into several different buckets, but maybe these buckets aren't even like the definitive. It's just kind of how we've decided to tackle the Sisyphean mountain of footage at our disposal. So there's kind of just general preservations, where we take an existing piece, don't edit it, and just show it as is. Then there are times where I don't want to show a feature film because you as the audience member would never come back if I showed the whole thing, because it's too boring or it's like doesn't make a lot of sense. But if I cut it down to 15 minutes, that is a different kind of presentation of this movie that is hard to show otherwise. That we called those faster piece theater, where we're just speeding it along, you know, because that's the pace of today. Basically, there, Jenny mentioned earlier in the interview, double faded, which is something that is probably the furthest reaches of our experiments. It's where I take music tracks, slow them down or alter them in a chopped and screwed kind of way, and then marry them to visuals that you wouldn't ordinarily expect them to go along with. And that creates, well, have you ever seen the Stuart Gordon movie From Beyond from the 80s?
No.
Okay. Well, it's a Lovecraft adaptation. It's very campy and insane. I highly recommend it. But the lead character, played by Jeffrey Combs, in the second half of the film, he's a mad scientist, and he doesn't realize that these experiments are physically affecting him in a Cronenbergian way. And the experiments activate his, I don't know if it's real, but they call it the pineal gland.
It's real.
It's okay. And
it doesn't look like it looks in the movie.
Yeah, in the movie, it extrudes like genitalia, like a third eye coming out of Jeffrey Combs' forehead. But it's not really about that. It's more about it's activating the fourth dimension for him. And I feel like the double faded segments really do open the door to a different dimension because of the cognitive dissonance, where you're like, what the hell is this music? What are these images?
And they're then very trippy,
but and then the question that I want people to walk away from those is, how am I supposed to feel about this? I want people to basically leave the entire show not knowing how to feel about what they just saw, because I feel like that is the enticement to get them to come back the next week, is like to finally figure out what are they watching, you know. What other buckets do we have? Church of Letterman is our just late night talk show bucket, where anything goes, because quite often on late night talk shows, anything did go.
There's also the Founders of Found Footage bucket.
Yeah, where we examine stuff from previous decades, both people who've made found footage pieces in eras past, And tapes that used to circulate on the collector circuit, you know, but before the internet, these found footage had a way of getting around and the underground network of tape trading. I love celebrating that because that's where this all started. And that's where I started.
Part of what I like about the whole found footage aesthetic is that everything's so goddamn polished now. Everything is so like marketed to hell, filtered to hell. I like the unvarnished sincerity of a lot of it. I like the idea that things can still be out there that are undiscovered and unappreciated. It makes me feel connected to humanity on some level.
I have been personally highly, highly, highly influenced by both TV Carnage and Everything is Terrible for different reasons. They're the two most influential found footage outlets so far, I think, in terms of how people make this stuff. TV Carnage was super important to me because his name is Derek Beckles, the guy who does TV Carnage. He taught me through his work that it is important to let a clip breathe. And that was his contribution to the found footage lineage, was not only finding some of the best, craziest stuff, but also the rhythms, knowing how to play the audience like this is jazz, because this is jazz, really. Jazz is a lot of solos. It's taking something out of the air and origamiing it into something you can recognize.
Who's next?
Raymond, the male counterpart. And he is definitely a punk.
What does punk mean?
Punk, as a fashion, is a rebellion of urban living and of teenagers. He's wearing studs, ripped t-shirt to fit him, running shoes, chains. It's all very angry and rattly. And it's like rattling of bars of prisoners.
And locks? What do the locks mean?
The locks are, again, rebellion. Again, frustration, anger.
And do they dance? Is there such a thing as punk dancing?
I think they're going to show you what it's about.
Everything is Terrible was highly influential to me, not only because I personally know them and got to do events with them, but also that their pace is unparalleled. They can activate your psychedelic sense, I think, better than any other group doing found footage stuff because, well, they have a lot of psychedelic experience, that, you know, I'll guess at that. And they know how to translate that chemical feeling to a tangible viewing experience. Like, I think all drug scenes from major motion pictures are usually bunk, but if you want a true representation of like exploring a different plane of existence, I think Everything is Terrible's work does the job.
At this time, we are going to look at you as if you were a product.
You can see the difference.
Now our task is to promote that product so that it gains wide acceptance in the marketplace.
Egg Genie, Egg Genie, Egg Genie, Egg Genie, Egg Genie.
Time Ring.
Egg Genie, Egg Genie, Egg Genie, Egg Genie, Egg Genie.
Flavor Wave Turbo.
What we do at the Museum of Home Video is a kind of hybrid of those two styles with an added dimension of the acknowledgement of the lockdown and trying to give people a video lifeline.
I think we are more than a found footage show. I think we are a variety show.
Yes, that is something that we've tried to lay down from the beginning. Also, this is an incredibly pretentious phrase that I'll throw out. And I was trying to think of like, what is a three-word or four-word phrase that describes what we're doing beyond variety show. Now, stop me if this is too silly, but I think what we are doing is symphonic video journalism. Each show's content is like a mixtape, you know, like the classic, put the cassette in the deck and like put that song on there and then put this song next. Though mixtapes are symphonies. You are trying to bring the listener to a variety of places. Like there's a waveform to how the symphony should affect you when you listen to it. I think that the layout of the video pieces across a certain episode, again, it's pretentious, I'm acknowledging it, but it is a symphony because I'm trying to bring you in a series of highs and lows, and I want you to, and I'm harping on it, I want you to feel something, and I want you to reconsider what you've seen at the end under the context of how you felt about it.
So it's like, you know, all these heavyweights, like, you know, Ben Stiller, Jack Black, Robert Downey Jr., everybody, and then at the end is like me, like, you know, like, hey, just happy to be here, guys. You know, like, and some other supporting guys, and then Tom Cruise walks in,
my God.
And even those guys are like, whoa, and he's super stoked to be there, you know, just like, yeah, oh, boom, you know, like, he's like,
wow,
he's just immediately excited when he walks into a room. And so he comes over and he sits next to me, and I think he had been briefed on some of the mm-hmm. supporting guys, but he was like trying to place me, you know? So he sat down next to me and he's like, I love your work.
Another factor that I think we excel at that is different in the space of found footage creation is journalism. I think that our work takes on a journalistic feel, a documentary feel, in addition to making you laugh or sneer or flinch or whatever. We did a piece a couple weeks ago that was a redo of something I did a few years ago, which is called The Museum Guide to Virtual Reality. And it was, I think, a documentary exploration of how these things were laid out in film and TV. So in the 90s and 2000s, representation of virtual reality in film and TV was a joke because film and TV made it a joke. But we explored it from, okay, here are film clips that are wacky, and here are some documentary clips interwoven in it that give the context for it. I think a big part of what we do that's pretty novel is actually giving context to the footage you're watching. And I think that that makes you feel it more.
You don't always see the value in it at first, but the fact that, you know, if we can save these things and pore over them and present them and see what life was like and see what people were doing, see what entertained people, you know, there's value to that.
When a show does like 300 episodes a year, they're not too precious about this episode or that, unless it's some megastar that comes on. I remember the joy that I found watching this clip of the actress Jennifer Tilly on the Arsenio Hall show from the late 80s. She's a legendary eccentric actress, and Arsenio Hall was like the cool late night talk show at that time. But even so, they had a lot of airtime to fill, and she's kind of off the rails, and he's not that good of an interviewer in the first place. So it just creates this magical moment, which no one at the time thought anything of. It's just like, oh, it's another Tuesday on the Arsenio Hall show. But because they didn't pay any attention to the actual quality of the show, because they're too busy making the show, it's really fascinating to go back and isolate certain segments out of the 1,000+ episodes of the show, because they, like I said, they didn't, it's not that they didn't care. They just had, were just barreling through and trying to get through the day. And they would have no concept to save that episode for like the highlight reel, because to them it might've been a low light because it was totally off the rails. But to us, it really highlights the fragility of the late night talk show format and how one tear in the fabric can completely blow the whole thing open, kind of like a balloon deflating or bursting open. And those are the moments which I think they provide the most revelatory fun for the audience, when we can take something that was previously the producers of a show wished didn't happen and then bring them to the table. And they've long since forgotten about it, because again, it was just another Tuesday. A lot of our stuff comes from VHS. Originally, it was taped on tape and then transferred at some point, uploaded to a torrent site. Without this process, the vast majority of most television, at least, would be lost. Let's take MTV, for example. They're not in any hurry to release air checks of old MTV broadcasts because they don't have the music rights to do so. Our commentary is pretty political. That's another dimension which sometimes isn't present in other found footage makers, because, you know, a lot of times found footage makers are going for comedy, or they're going for an experimental feeling, you know, like your Bruce Conner lineage. But we are investigating political subjects, you know, showing something from the 80s, like a compilation of the Morton Downey Jr. Show, which was a very hot button political show. And it's also comedy seen now, but through the lens of today and MAGA and right wingers and libertarians and alt-right, it's important to see where some of this stuff comes from. And there is comedy in it, but I feel you can't show that comedy. You can't show a Wally George or a Morton Downey Jr. clip without giving the context of what it means today and how we got here from what you're about to see. And even pieces which don't seem political on the surface to me have a political reading, like the piece we just aired, was it last week or the week before, where we took footage of urban explorers spelunking in abandoned movie theaters. To me, this is political, because in our current moment, we can't go to the movie theater, and it represents just how shattered into a million shards our society has become because of what has happened in 2020. So when I first saw this footage on YouTube of urban explorers going into abandoned movie theaters, at first I was like, oh, that's incredible. It reads like Andrzej Zulawski's On the Silver Globe. It reads like a post-apocalypse sci-fi first-person shooter type exploration of an abandoned planet, but it's really like New Hampshire or Oregon or Texas. And it's stuff that was filmed in the last year or two. So it's like, this is our America. There's no shying away from it.
You know, that's a perfect example. That's something that's thrown in the middle of a show that had some other funny things. And then there's just this melancholy but beautiful video piece in the middle, and everybody's, you know, sort of struck by it. So, you know, we're not just tuning in to appreciate things from an ironic distance and laugh because we're better than it, you know?
Although I do enjoy doing that. There's nothing wrong with
that. Oh, sure, for sure. We're not above that. But I feel like it's lazy if that's all you do, you know? I'm just not interested in that, you know? There is nothing wrong with a little sincerity now and then. Come on, it's 2021. And that being said, too, I think a big difference with the IRL show versus online, you know, Brett and I are creating these things in a bit of a vacuum, where it's just the two of us sending videos back and forth. What do you think of this? Is this good? But having that chat, you know, it's different than a live audience where, you know, you hear some titters or you hear it, you know, people are able to very specifically articulate what they think of a piece. And it's always funny to me when something gets an outsized reaction, whether good or bad, and Brett comes back from the piece and he's like, whoa, I did not expect that to be so controversial, or I did not expect that you guys were going to hate that so much or love that so much.
I was just compelled to do that once I saw that footage for the first time. Someone in the chat was asking where it was. It's an amalgamation of somewhere between 15 and 20 different locations covered by Urban X videos. I can't quite get a handle on if the Urban X community is like libertarian or what. You know how those subcultures might seem cool at first, but then you peel back a layer or two and you have no idea until you really investigate it.
There it is, huh, guys? Well, we're gonna have to do something here. The Earth's in trouble. I guess it's up to us.
It's up to us?
Don't just wait for the politicians. Come on. They're gonna read an opinion poll one day and go, maybe now I'll do something.
And what if the worst case of this happened? Or even half the worst case? And they ask us, did we see this coming? Did we know that this could happen?
Excuse me, can I sit here?
No, go ahead, it's free country.
Yeah. Hi, I'm every man.
Hi.
And you?
Every lawyer.
Really?
Yeah.
Who do you represent?
People.
What people?
What do you think of what's going on around here?
Well, I'm a little concerned.
About what?
Well, to begin with, the oceans are polluted.
What, the oil slicks?
Yeah, that's it.
What's your name again?
Every man.
Every man. Did you ever see an oil slick?
Oh, well, just on TV.
Yeah, but not personally.
No.
Every man.
Yeah.
You know a lot of people.
Well, yes, I do.
Ever spoken to anybody that's seen an oil slick?
No.
Must be a lot of ocean that doesn't have oil slicks.
Yeah, right? I guess, yeah.
So what's the problem?
I don't know. Well, it's polluted, you know?
Worst case scenario.
All right.
Let's say the oil slicks over every ocean in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Means you can't swim in them.
Yeah.
You can't fish in them.
Well.
You can always do something. You could take a little sailboat.
Well, my jet ski.
Putt-putt. There you go.
Well, what if the water gets on you, though?
Let's say you're on a freeway going 60 miles an hour.
Yeah?
Do you put your hand out the window and try to touch the ground?
No way. No.
So when you're in a boat and the ocean gets on you, you keep your hands inside the boat.
Yeah, you better.
You don't touch the water. It doesn't touch you.
What about the fish, though?
Let's take your worst case scenario.
Okay.
Let's say all the fish in the world are poisoned.
Really?
Dead. You can't eat them anymore.
Yeah.
Nobody will be able to eat fish.
Right.
You ever taste imitation crab meat?
Once, yeah.
Isn't it delicious?
It was.
Tell me the truth. Could you tell the difference?
No, well, it was a little stringy, but...
Yeah, it's better than having a dead crab.
Dead crab?
You ever try to break open a dead crab?
No.
All right. Now they have imitation crab meat. Soon they'll have imitation tuna, imitation swordfish, imitation wahoo.
The imitation wahoo?
Not yet.
Oh, really?
But if they pollute all the oceans, they'll start working on them. What other problems you got?
I think that our audience enjoys... the kind of emotional detective work when they see something. Like, when I hit play on something, the audience doesn't know if they're going to be affected by it or not, because that's kind of the tone of our show, like a buckshot of emotion. And I think that a lot of what we show gives the audience the opportunity to explore their own past and the relationship to their past and where they are now. Like, the show doesn't exist without people acknowledging that we're in lockdown. So I think that showing ancient material, which somehow relates to their current experience, that's what I hope that they're feeling. It's kind of like being in it's a very 80s metaphor, but the game show where you step inside a plastic tube chamber and then an air blast would shoot dollar bills into it and you have to grab the dollar bills. That is what putting the show together is like, and not breaking into the bank and stealing the vault. It's like trying to shield yourself from a sandstorm, basically. I don't know if there's anything too personal in the archive. A lot, everything seems grist for the mill to me, even things that I'm in as a child. Maybe they'll one day make an appearance on the show. I'm certainly traversing that boundary with friends who are trusting me enough to edit their home movies when they were children and put them on the show. I've done that once. And I have a couple other pieces slated to do so. There are things in my found footage collection in the specifically the area of found footage and not movies and TV, just like weird tapes from nowhere. There's one called The Healing of John Wernicke's Finger. John Wernicke had some finger trauma happen, and so it's a video diary of the healing of his finger. Why does this exist? I don't know. I found it in a thrift store. And because I worked at a video store in the 2000s, we put the tape as a rental in our store in the experimental section. I don't want to show it to anybody, but I've kept it because you never know. Something that has loomed in my mind in the last few days, because I just caught a reference to it, is hauntology. It started as a musical form, probably in the 2000s, as a it's nostalgia eating itself. It's music specifically for ghosts. And I am a huge listener of vaporwave. It's a lot of my everyday email writing music. I work to vaporwave my vaporwave playlist a lot. And that is a furthering an evolution of hauntology, where it's specifically about like 90s mall memories. My work is just as informed by vaporwave as it is by TV carnage, because we are living in an age where all we have is our memories. And I think that is maybe the most potent audience tractor beam at the moment. What I'm noticing is that this whole DIY quarantine streaming thing is kind of like zine culture mixed with a little bit of social media and podcasting crossover elements into this interesting college radio for your eyes thing that I've been talking about. Oh, and I've gone out. I'll fix that later. Oh, I almost forgot that I've got, look at this. Boop! We've got lower thirds sort of now. So museum of home video.com.